More often than not, your airbrush will warn you before something bad is about to happen. That can be as simple as just listening to the air coming out of the brush, or it can be a little more abrupt and in your face. It's a very good idea to get into the habit of spraying your airbrush either in the palm of your hand, on a scrap piece of paper, on the backboard of your easel, anything other than your actual project before you begin working. That was a commissioned t-shirt I was working on in that clip. So let's talk about what we just watched. When I'm talking about aiming your airbrush at anything other than your actual project, I want you to activate the air and the air only. I'm not pulling the trigger back to release any paint. Why would I want to do this? I want to make sure no paint is escaping the airbrush when it's not supposed to be. If you noticed in that clip, I did spray air into the palm of my hand before I actually went to the shirt. The downside to that is I was using Wicked Driscoll Flesh Tone at that point. When paint is escaping from your airbrush when it's not supposed to be, it's going to be a small amount of paint. So I didn't necessarily feel anything in my hand other than the air, and I didn't see it because the Driscoll Flesh Tone is not terribly different from my own skin tone. But in that clip, I activated the air and the air only when I went to the shirt. I did not pull the trigger back on the airbrush to release any paint. So paint was escaping the airbrush when it was not supposed to be. Fortunately, this wasn't a huge issue in this particular instance. Where the paint was released was a portion of the shirt that I was planning to paint anyway, and it was relatively easy to cover up. If I had sprayed any other part of the shirt, then I may have had to scrap it and start all over and take that loss. So let's talk about what was actually happening. This is essentially what the fluid nozzle of your airbrush looks like. Very magnified. This is a hollow part, so your airbrush needle will protrude through the fluid nozzle from this direction, and then the tip of the needle protrudes through the tip of the fluid nozzle. So other than the needle, this is a hollow space when you're operating your airbrush. Once you begin operating your airbrush, this fills up with paint. The downside with most of the paint that we use while airbrushing is it's all pigment based. Pigment means particles. They're very small particles of paint, but they are particles of paint. That's what creates the color in each individual bottle of paint you use, along with a lot of other ingredients. The main issue we're talking about here are those particles of pigment. Those particles of pigment do not dissolve. They remain particles, and that can cause issues. What happens is your fluid nozzle is building up with paint over time. It takes a while before this actually begins causing issues unless you routinely tear your airbrush down and clean it thoroughly. But eventually you'll build up enough paint on the inside of the fluid nozzle that it begins to build up near the tip, and it won't let the needle seat against the tip of the fluid nozzle. Once that happens, there's a small gap around that fluid tip and the needle, and paint can still escape when only the air is activated. The correct way to remedy this problem would obviously be to take the front of your airbrush apart, remove the fluid nozzle, and clean it thoroughly. I chose not to do that. The alternative is you can remove the handle on your airbrush, loosen the needle chuck, pointing away from your project. You can work the needle back and forth just a little bit, and that will usually be enough to dislodge any little particles of pigment that are keeping the needle from seating correctly. Again, the correct way to do this would be to take the fluid nozzle out of the airbrush and clean it thoroughly. I was in the middle of a job, didn't want to stop to clean the fluid nozzle of my airbrush. So this is what I chose to do. Once you do that, you're actually loading the tip of the needle with paint and pigment. So make sure when you tighten your needle chuck back up, put your handle back on, go to your hand, back of your easel, spare piece of paper, whatever it is, and spray air only and blow all of that pigment off the tip of the needle, not onto the surface of your project. That will work to alleviate the problem for a little while, but you still have a lot of paint and pigment built up in this fluid nozzle, and it will eventually happen again. Whether it happens during that particular painting session is hit and miss, but it will happen again. I started experiencing issues again soon after I started this project. I know it's difficult to tell in that particular clip because the problem I experienced is not the same problem we just discussed. The issue was the same, the problem was slightly different. I wasn't happy with how my airbrush was performing because the paint wasn't starting exactly when I expected it to. With a lot of time and practice behind your airbrush, you will develop what's called muscle memory, meaning you will know just by feel exactly when the paint should start flowing on your airbrush without even thinking about it. And you guys are all aware of how little movement it takes rocking that trigger back to begin the paint flow. The issue in this case is, again, a lot of paint built up in the fluid nozzle. Those little pigment particles can build up toward the tip of your fluid nozzle, and that can slow the paint down as it's flowing through the airbrush, and that can cause erratic performance. Again, the correct way to address this issue is to remove the fluid nozzle from the airbrush and clean it thoroughly. Again, I was in the middle of a job. I didn't want to take the time to take my airbrush apart or switch to another airbrush. I wanted to keep working. So once again, I removed the handle of the airbrush needle, loosened the needle chuck, and I started working the airbrush trigger, not the trigger, but the airbrush needle back and forth, again, to dislodge any paint that was built up near this area. And it worked. Again, it's a temporary fix. I made it through the rest of this particular job, but the correct course of action would be to take the airbrush apart and clean it thoroughly. You can actually see slightly what I was doing, although a lot of it was out of view of the camera. But if we go back to that clip, you'll see me working the airbrush on the backboard of my easel, and you can actually see when I spray the paint off of the tip of the fluid needle. So the point behind this video is pay attention to your equipment. Whether that's something you hear or it's something you feel, if you train yourself to recognize those clues when your airbrush is telling you that something's a little off, there's a pretty good chance you will avoid having to make a repair on your project later. I'm not suggesting that you should completely tear down your airbrush after every use and thoroughly clean it. That's really not necessary. As I stated before, it takes a while before these issues creep up. You have to recognize that each time you use your brush, if you're not pulling the fluid nozzle out and thoroughly cleaning it, a small amount of residual paint winds up left inside the fluid nozzle that builds, that dries and builds over time. As that paint builds, it makes it easier for the particles of pigment to create these issues. I hope all of that makes sense. I hope you guys got something out of this. If you did, remember to like, subscribe, and share. I'm Trevor with Wicked Art Studio. I'll see you guys next time.